Did you hear that? It's the sound of pirates. What about that? That's also the sound of pirates, though of a different nature. That was the sound of an illegal digital copy of a film being downloaded from a file-sharing website. So, which of the two is more dangerous? In the opinion of major motion picture studios, it's the latter. You see, the bulk of revenue that a studio earns from any particular film comes not from the theater. In fact, unless a film has the magic of Harry Potter or the obnoxious glitter of Twilight, its box office revenues won't even cover marketing costs. Most revenue comes from the secondary markets, TV licensing fees, merchandising, and of course, DVD sales. Hollywood claims that illegal downloads are taking the place of these DVD sales, accounting for more than $250 billion in losses. That's a lot more value than you could put on the average pirate ship on the high seas. But if you follow that figure back to its source, you find that there is a lot more legend than fact there. The $250 billion number came from a sidebar in an article in a 1991 issue of Forbes magazine. That's right, Hollywood is basing its claims on figures that are over 20 years old, before the internet even moved fast enough to make an online movie download practical. Not only that, but the original $250 billion was an estimate of the total global market for counterfeit goods, which includes both pirated films and knockoff handbags. A more recent and less publicized estimate of the profit damage from piracy is $446 million, a lot less threatening. And that represents only about a third of the worldwide gross of the final Harry Potter film. Even if you try to sink the argument that piracy drains billions from the film industry, the studios will not let up on their assertion that online file sharing of pirated film content is dooming the industry. The losses may not be big now, but they will only grow exponentially in the future. The problem, in the end, is not legal, with issues of copyright, as much as it is economic. It's called the free rider problem, and it deals with a public good that is both non-rivalrous and non-excludable. A film is a perfect example of a public good. My watching of a film does not prevent you from seeing it, unless every theater in the world is sold out and I have the last ticket. And it is relatively non-excludable. As long as you can afford a ticket, or a computer with which to download the film illegally, you can enjoy the good. The problem is, with relatively limited boundaries to access to the good, everyone seems to take as much as they want. So what's wrong with that? Everyone sees as many films as they want, so everyone wins, right? Wrong. Someone, somewhere, has to pay to maintain that public good that everyone is enjoying. In this case, it's the movie studios, who undertake the financial burden of production and labor cost to make those movies that are then consumed by the public. Those who do not pay for the film do not contribute to the cost of the public good, and are thus free riding on the time and money of others, the film studios. The studios ultimately depend on consumers for revenue to produce their next film, but if everyone is free riding, the market falls apart. Looking at it from this perspective, unless the file sharers are stopped dead in their tracks, Hollywood will keep sinking slowly until the industry is drowned. Okay, enough of the pirate metaphors, and enough of this talk of inevitable doom. Does piracy really mean the end of Hollywood, and the end of movies altogether? Absolutely not, though it does mean changes ahead. I sat down with Dr. Don Dale, Associate Professor of Economics at Muhlenberg College, to discuss the future of the industry as it stands today, if piracy continues.
I think that movie stars aren't going to be nearly as ridiculously wealthy. I think a lot of money is going to leave the industry. I think that it will definitely be less lucrative. Whether it will be possible to come out with these major, incredibly expensive blockbusters, I'm not sure that's going to be able to be possible in the face of piracy, in the face of ever better digital transmission technology. I'm not sure that's going to be possible. I'm sure it's still going to be ever easier to make a record. While it's harder and harder to make piles of money in the music industry, it's easier and easier to put something out there, right? In the same way, it's only going to get easier to make a movie, right? And if you've got something original and creative to say, making your own movie is going to be ever easier. On the other hand, it's going to be really hard to make piles and piles of money from that.
Could you make a little money?
You could probably make a little money, right.
So the way things are headed now, it appears as though independent filmmakers are the future of cinema, as file sharing dismantles the Hollywood Walk of Fame. And those independent filmmakers are certainly up to the challenge. I got a first-hand look at how independents are collaborating both to produce and distribute their work at the 2012 DIY Days Conference in New York City.
I'm producing a transmedia documentary about young changemakers in Jerusalem called Jerusalem Unfiltered.
I don't really wait for money or opportunities to come my way. And what I am looking for is collaborators to share a similar passion for cinema.
We're looking for some help or some advice
and help.
The film has had a really nice reception by audiences, but I haven't been very good at knowing how to do distribution or marketing.
And the film was finished about 3 months ago. In honor of DIY Days this morning, I put the first 10 minutes of the film up online.
One of the event's attendees, University of Central Florida Associate Professor Randy Finch, pointed back to the internet as the key component of future film revenue models.
I used to make films, independent films, that were primarily intended to be sold by the old gatekeepers, like Miramax did the last three movies. And about 10 years ago, I despaired of that model, and I didn't know what was going to replace it. It seems as if revenue models are emerging online, and for me, the question isn't how do you get the money to make the movie, it's how do you pay back the people who gave you the money. So for non-traditional sort of what we call indie filmmakers, I don't think where you get the money is really going to change. And I tweeted you, it's in my view, it's credit cards, family, and rich dentists. And I think that's more or less going to remain the same. The question is, how do you pay those people back? And I think the internet is starting to show us ways that you can monetize content online.
All right, that all sounds well and good, but one major question still remains. How do independent films, or any films in general for that matter, plan to profit in a market where the competitor is giving away everything for free? As Dr. Don Dale describes, the trick is not to rely on the movie itself as the product, but rather to build another service around the content, distribute the film for free, and establish a separate revenue stream to support your business. Dale favors a Google-esque advertising model.
One way to try and sort of solve your problem, right? You're conceiving of like a website or a service where people would go to download movies. And so I was thinking about how you could make that a destination rather than, you know, that's not just simply YouTube or something. And I mean, this is probably not the only way, but if you could do something like the Netflix recommendation system or mm-hmm. something very similar, right? And it would be very, it would be almost Google-ish in its data mining, right? So what you'd have to do is you'd have to have a whole lot of people using this service, and then you'd have a data miner that says, well, people who watch the movies you watch, they also watch this. And so that might be something you might be interested in. Now, obviously, when there's four people who use this website, that recommendation is going to be crap. But the more people use that website as their sort of main consumable source of movies, right? The more that means the better you get to understand their preferences and how their preferences match up with other people. So you need a lot of people using it, and you need a lot of people using it a lot.
With this model, the free rider problem is eliminated. Audiences do the work producing preference data for the film site, which that site can then sell to third parties seeking to better target advertising. And Don Dale is not alone in his sentiment. Ryan Aynes, Vice President of Digital Strategy at Ogilvy, a social marketing firm, echoed the importance of numbers and data to financial success in independent filmmaking.
We live in an era now where what people want to hear is numbers. And so if you were to go into a studio or anywhere and pitch your idea around, I can make sure that a million people are going to see that. You know, or I know that I have a way that I can put this on YouTube and get 10,000 comments, right? So you can translate that, those 10,000 comments, those million views, that's because people are excited about the product. They're excited about what they're actually doing. It's not like it's tangible results. The thing that really matters the most is when you dive deep, you start with impressions and you just go deeper, 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 and when you're able to show like core consumer metrics. So, wow, like this hashtag was shared by 13,000 females between the ages of 18 and 24. You know, everyone's eyes light up. And that means like their core consumer was talking about their product online. Try to think more business-minded about what your project is and what you're doing, what your film is. You know, a lot of people want to make a big movie and raise $1 million to do that. Well, why don't you think about just gathering $5,000 and making a really awesome webisode and putting it online, and then somehow figuring a way to get a mass following around that webisode that's going to lead you to generate maybe some ad revenue, maybe some additional word of mouth, some buzz, and then sell a brand in on that and turn that 5-minute webisode into a half hour, you know, webisode. And then all of a sudden you can get enough following around that, turn it into a movie. You know, like there are like so many different ways to get your thing done outside raising major masses of amounts of capital, but you gotta be realistic about it and you gotta start small. And so Kickstarter is great, but don't ever bet your future on someone else's money.
Independent filmmaker Eric Dietel found success on Kickstarter with a short comic book based film, When Suddenly. His experiences demonstrate another key aspect to the future of indie film financing, community engagement.
I also think that what sells most on Kickstarter is this idea of some sort of inclusion. The highest level donations we got were for credits in the film. It's the inclusive thing that I didn't realize at first. I thought it would be more the objects that people were interested in being a part of. And it was like, oh, if I donate this much, I get this prize. But it was more like, if I donate this much, I'm at like this level of like the team, you know, and like inclusion.
It sounds cool to say I was a producer of this.
Right. It's not a like title and name only. Like donating that amount of funds directly like leads to purchasing very important things for the movie, which is what producers do, you know.
Yeah.
Like, so it's not like, oh, we'll call you the producer if you donate. It's like you've literally taken on that role for us, and like we thank you. It's the idea of like we all made this together that like sold the whole concept through Kickstarter.
So where has this journey taken us? We started off with Hollywood as the victim, with pirates plundering profits away. But looking at alternative revenue models, online distribution, and the rise of independent film collaboration, perhaps pirates aren't the villain in this story. In fact, there may not be a villain here at all, just a natural wave of new media creation crashing down on the shores of old school Hollywood. I think the question we should be asking here isn't how studios can close off the data streams leaking from closed doors, but how they can open the floodgates to the online market and still collect their share of the treasure. There's still fortunes to be had for big names and independents alike in the industry. But if Hollywood spends too much time chasing pirates, they may find more money has fallen into the hands of independents, which may not necessarily be a bad thing.